All right, today we're going to be talking about knowledge management with one of my favorite tools, Obsidian. Obsidian is effectively, for me, where I keep track of my engineering logs, my notes, any highlights I have from books I've read or articles I've read, any bookmarks I have, any links that I think are really valuable that I might want to find later, as well as example code. I'm a developer, so I spend a lot of time tracking different solutions to different problems. So a lot of that stuff ends up in here. And Obsidian is like a central store for all of that information. You can perform analysis or search and be able to reference this store as a kind of consistent place to find kind of everything that you're looking for. In more traditional like knowledge management, you'd have like a separate app for each one of these kind of experiences generally. You might use your browser for bookmarks. You might have example code stored in a code repository. You might have your highlights stored in whatever highlighting app you use. And then similarly, like you have separate like notes and logs, but Obsidian helps put it all in one place and give you a lot of interesting capabilities and extensions to be able to leverage that in a really good way. And today I'm going to talk about how Cursor can actually leverage what you've already done in Obsidian and give you an improved path to be able to perform analysis and search, give you some really amazing things that you can do with AI with your knowledge base in Obsidian. So first, let's talk a little bit about what Cursor is. Cursor is this AI code editor. That's effectively what it's most well known for. It's replaced the current industry standard code editor for a lot of us that are really into AI. And so it does a lot of really amazing things where you can, one, autocomplete, of course, like finish what code you're writing, but you can also ask it to perform certain actions like this, and it'll actually run through the code and perform those code actions. It uses several models to be able to do this, but it has one of the kind of best interfaces for AI coding that I've experienced. It's actually convinced me to cancel my GitHub Copilot, which previously has been like the industry standard tool for this sort of thing. I've talked before about other AI tools for Obsidian. How is Cursor a bit different? Because Cursor is a tool for coding, effectively it's an editor for being able to understand a lot of raw files in a lot of different code types. Text is just another raw file. And so we can really just very easily think about it as our code base is the same as our knowledge base here, and we can leverage it. So this is my Obsidian instance here that I have. I've got my kind of home page and a map of kind of the core links that I might go through on a day-to-day. I've also got a bunch of different folders that I've set up in here, and I've just got my workflow that I use within my Obsidian space here. Let's actually open up my Obsidian folder now in Cursor. So here's my Cursor that's actually running, and I've got this folder Ben Personal, which is my Obsidian instance that I'm running off of. So in here, now you can see I've loaded up all of my Obsidian Markdown files, and we can actually go find that same file that we had before. So if we look at it inside of Obsidian, we've got it here. It's got very nice kind of markup interpretation. And then when we go inside of Cursor, this is going to be just like the raw markdown that kind of exists that you'll be going off of. Very different view, but yeah, it's the same code, right? When you first pull in all of your Obsidian into Cursor, you might note that there's a bit of a lag. And that's actually because if we go into the features, one of the first things it has to do is sync your code base, right? It's actually going to generate a lot of embeddings that help Cursor better understand what all the files are that exist inside of your code base. And it'll allow Cursor to more easily find documents within your codebase. You can, of course, tweak this a bit. So if there are files that you think need to be ignored, I've got a lot of Excalidraw files. Maybe that's something I might start ignoring here. So I could go in here and configure the ignored files. And I could say anything that's .excalidraw.md, I think should actually be ignored. So that might be something I add. So now we've got that added there as a configured ignored file there. And so now those files won't be updated unless I do that. When you first just load it up, just note that this may need to fully sync before you see anything, right? If you have issues and you've synced it and things are acting weird, you might delete the sync and then go in and ignore some more files or folders. But you'll just have to play with that a little bit if you've got a very unique Obsidian setup. But for me, even just the base configuration worked just fine. Okay, great. Now that we've got Obsidian imported into Cursor, let's take a look at how we might ask a question. We can open up the AI plane over here. And inside of here, we can actually ask it a question about something about our Obsidian instance here. For me, one thing I do a lot is I ask a lot of questions about different AI tools that I've used. So I might ask a question like this: what was the AI tool for evaluating prompts and testing? So I can send that out. If you just ask the question directly and you don't add any context, it's just going to try and ask the whatever model that you're asking for that question. But if I hit command and then enter, or I click this code base run here, it's actually going to search through all of my files to be able to try and find one that tells me about evaluating prompts. But yep, it found the one that I was thinking of, which was prompt foo. And so that's great. That's exactly the one I was looking for. And you can always click this new chat button if you want to open up a new chat. Another use case that you might have is you might want to ask a question. You might ask something like this: what's the latest post I created on Stable Discussion, and what was the topic? That might be a good one to look for. It searched through all the different ones, and it's actually got it correct. The correct answer was a content hollowness, which was entry 26 in all of my AI posts for Stable Discussion, which is great. And so it was able to go through and get that out, which is that guy there. Now, of course, it's not able to actually traverse the linking between the different files, which does cause a bit of a problem to some degree, because it's not able to track ideas across the entire code base, but because it's able to see things from multiple perspectives, it can put stuff together. So I could ask a follow-up question like, what is AI content hollowness about? Now, it's going to try and do this with the current context that it knows, what it searched for and through before. Now, I think this one, it was able to pull some of the data that it had before, but it wasn't complete. So what I could do is I can add the context for AI content hollowness and say, use this full document to answer my previous question. So now it's actually going to go look through that whole document. And now it's actually going to give me some information about, okay, what was that about, and give me some takeaways about it. This is a really good kind of use case. It's able to not only find things that I was looking for, but it can actually find things that are more difficult to find, things that may not be like directly indexed. In this case, it was actually looking through all the posts and it found like the most recent post that was created, which is somewhat surprising. I thought this might actually be more difficult for it to do. Now, one thing that I can do that is interesting here is I can further go and I can include a few files for it to reference, and I can try to do a bit of a brainstorm here. I can say something like this: I've got my bookmarks, I've got my previous YouTube video ideas, my kind of pending video ideas that I've already created. And I'd say, based on my current YouTube ideas and bookmarks, I have interesting links. Give me 5 examples with a sentence description each. So now it's actually going to look through all the past videos that I've done and combine that with the bookmarks that I have, interesting links, interesting things that I've found, and it's going to try and combine those down into something interesting for me. So this is an example of like brainstorming. So the first one here, the power of AI-assisted diagramming from concept to code. Eraser.io, Diagram.GPT can revolutionize how developers and designers communicate ideas. Interesting. There's an interesting idea there. Beyond ChatGPT, exploring innovative AI interfaces for developers. Cursor, Lobe Chat, Open Web UI. Yeah, there's some interesting stuff there. AI-powered code review. There's something interesting there. The rise of AI and web design from Figma to Framer. I don't think Framer's the end result. It's a cool idea, but maybe not quite there. Mastering AI documentation from Swim to Mintlify. I don't even remember Mintlify. That could be cool. I have no idea. Oh, Mintlify is this cool documentation service that has a nice AI chat built into it and some really interesting API interfaces and stuff. Yeah, this is a very cool like system. It does look really cool. I want to look into it more. So that's potentially a good video. You can find like some interesting things where it's just mixing and matching stuff that you've already curated and thought of, and just pushing you in a new way, something that you might not have thought of before. Another thing that you could do is actually take maybe a file or a document that you already have and improve upon it. So for instance, I can highlight maybe this intro section and I can say, hey, I can say something like, so it might do something like this. Let's update this to be a catchier YouTube style introduction. Give me an outline and notes in the way that the source document already does. So I could submit that as an edit here. The ultimate AI powered knowledge hack. Okay. My AI journey, Obsidian, AI revelation, the problem, light bulb moment. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I don't know. That could have been a better intro. I prefer mine. Hey, that could be a way that you can like work on this though. It gives you some other ideas about how things might work. Another really cool thing is, say you had like a table, you might be able to use this to edit the columns in that table and be able to actually do some like really interesting stuff there. But those are just a few of the many features that you might actually run into when you're looking at what you can do with a really powerful tool like this, like Cursor. There's a ton of options, a ton of capabilities here for what you might do with it. And just the ability for it to be able to consume a lot of these different documents that already exist in your knowledge base is just great. Now the question, of course, becomes, okay, why do we need Obsidian now? Do we actually need this tool at all? And my answer for that is I still need Obsidian. I still use it for a lot of different things. I have a lot of workflows that I do that Obsidian really does a great job of powering in a way that Cursor doesn't. For starters, the Obsidian interface is much prettier. I'm much happier editing things here, being able to see colors and style, being able to go into a full text edit interface here without necessarily needing to think about it as like code or markdown, really. I know that, at least for me, I think I'm used to thinking in Obsidian and doing commands in Obsidian too. The one Obsidian thing that I use a lot is I really like QuickAdd as a plugin. So I'll use something like this. I'll add a daily note very quickly and I'll say, I'll do something like creating my YouTube video, right? And I'll submit that. And now when I look into my daily notes, you'll see that there's a timestamp on the day and it's immediately created this file if it didn't already exist and it added in my note. So that's just like a very quick example of something that's there. But also I do a lot of organization of different things here too. For me, my inbox is like a place where a lot of pending documents are stored. My notes is just a big folder where all of my kind of more long-term notes are. I don't do a lot of like organizing of that folder. I prefer that my systems do the organizing. I don't want to manage folders. I've got raw assets like all sorts of images or PNGs or PDFs. Those will all go in there. I've got maps of content. And so these will be like organizations of files. They're actually highlighted here on the homepage. And I might have like a map of AI that has a lot of my kind of other links to files within it. And so I've got like a flow already really set up inside of Obsidian in a way that is very hard to replicate inside of a code editor. Now, I know that there's a lot of like community plugins for VS Code, but for me, I really like to do my knowledge work separately from my code. And so for me, like what I'll end up doing is I'll probably be working on like a file very similar to this one. I'll be thinking through things and then I'll have a question. And so when I have that question, I'll go over to Cursor, I'll create a new thing and I'll say, hey, and I'll just ask the question that I have here, right? And then when I'm done with that, I'll just end up going back into Obsidian and keep writing. I'm not ever going to really switch into one or the other. For me, it's always about using the right tool for the right job. And so that's the reason why I think Cursor is just an awesome add for me. I think it does AI with Obsidian better than any of the other extensions that I've seen. It really allows you to have full control over your files in a way that a lot of more proprietary systems like Notion doesn't allow you to do. And then on top of that, you still get the flexibility of having a really amazing AI tool, being able to index and understand all the documents that you have, like Cursor. That's why for me, I think this kind of flow here is going to be a really powerful flow for me. And I'm already really excited to be leveraging it in my kind of day-to-day. All right. Well, thanks so much for tuning in. I hope this was enlightening to you. I'd love it if you'd subscribe and like. It really helps us out here on our channel. We also have a blog, blog.saleddiscussion.com, where you can find out more information about what we think about AI and some of our thinking there. If what we're talking about is interesting, we'd love it to hear from you there, hear from you down in the comments. And thank you so much. Have a good rest of your day.